Obviously, as COVID has impacted everything, it has impacted the sourcing of some of the materials that we need to finalize that project. But it should be on its way towards completion here soon. The Hotel Carmichael continues to be under construction, and we're looking towards a early August opening. So most of the stuff is done. It's just a kind of final sprint towards the finish line. We have a lot of events, including weddings, booked for August. So we're looking forward to having a strong opening. One of the items that is going to be under construction around City Center is these bathrooms that are just south of the hotel, across from the Chris Kindle Market, across from Carter Green, and construction of those should be starting shortly. One of the things I don't have pictured is the brick on the inside wall of the motor court in front of the hotel. That project got started today. The inside wall of the motor court has been just bare concrete for a long time, and one of the new projects Petcor is starting is to finish off that brick right as the hotel is set to open. The Playfair Holland construction continues at City Center along with the Kent, and you can see the brick, the masonry going up on the Kent already. The Gora construction and the Proscenium generally continues forward. That picture's a bit outdated because the two buildings that surround the Agora there, which is the corner office building, are fully framed out. And some of the commissioners and some of the plan commission members got and some of the counselors got a tour of that building. And the views from it are just incredible. And we're looking forward to a lot of the top quality jobs going into that office building here shortly. The Zotac headquarters is under construction and looking to open in January 2021. And the Franciscan Orthopedic Center of Excellence that this council approved in November is well on its way as well. And those are all the updates on construction projects, and I'm happy to answer any questions that council may have.
Any questions from council? Councilor Green?
Yeah. Henry, the hotel start date sometime in August. Is there any, you know, and I'm not sure what you can say, any detrimental impact on the delay continuing to the kind of the cash flow of the hotel?
No.
Councilor Austin.
Thank you, Madam President. I know we're going to be discussing changes to the rules with the garage. Is it possible to get some sort of physical railing or something built from the CRC perspective? Has that been discussed?
Do you mean at the top of the Veterans Way garage?
Yeah, that wouldn't fall under us, would it?
The top of the Veterans Way garage is already a wall, so it seems like what they were describing, someone was describing earlier, was kids jumping up on the wall that already acts as a railing for most people. And at a certain point, it's tough to prevent all illegal and frankly stupid activity from happening. If people want to be really dumb, there's not a way to prevent that. Just my opinion.
Any other questions of Councilor Green?
This is where Councilman of Finkman. When's the plan? Are we going to be discussing kind of what was reviewed concerning the hotel at one of the next finance meetings?
Councilor Finkman.
Yeah, the delay is on my part, and I'll bring that to you directly, and then we can decide what we want to do with it.
Okay. Any other questions for Director Mostetsky? No? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 11B, Carmel Historic Preservation Commission. I requested just a written report for this meeting, which should be in your packets. Item K, report on the Carmel Music and Film Festival, Nancy Heck.
Hello, council, councilors. As Laura said, Nancy Heck, Director of Community Relations and Economic Development for the City of Carmel. have a very brief report. The committee has been working mostly on funding opportunities, so they are looking into an NEA grant, and also a local private company has expressed an interest in being a naming sponsor. So that's where most of their, majority of their activities are focused these days.
Councillor Finkham.
Thank you. Nancy, I guess I'm confused. Work continues with the on this festival. I know you said in the article following the council's comments that was at the first meeting in June, I believe, that we're not in support of this continuing to move forward. And your comments were that we're still going to work on it in hopes of getting additional dollars from the council. What is your end game?
So, and I'm going to clarify intent on those comments. I see a long history with this festival. So my comment that council might be able to put money toward it is in subsequent years. I'm always hopeful. I'm always an optimist. I don't think I could have my job without being an optimist. Mm-hmm. Every other event that we started this way, with some pushback and some budget worries and things like that. So it doesn't surprise me that this starts in the same way. So that doesn't mean that we can't find other funding. So whether or not council gives money doesn't mean that this festival is going forward or not going forward. So I wanted to clarify that with the public, because they felt that because you weren't giving money that it wasn't happening. That doesn't mean we can't find alternate sources of funding.
So you can confirm that no other departments or anything are sending any dollars to this?
I'm sorry, it's kind of echoey with the thing, so
you can confirm that no other departments are putting any dollars toward this, correct?
No.
So we're not using, just because we didn't do Art of Wine or pick a festival that's been delayed, those dollars are not being diverted to this festival, correct?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
The money that they are working under right now is money that was granted earlier in the year that was for that purpose.
So, and that should have been $175,000. That was $125,000 from this year's budget, and $50,000 that was carried over from last year.
Yes, and that's the grant that they got for this year. Sorry, I shouldn't tap the table.
And then you're trying to get this $150,000 federal grant as well.
And to be clear, this is for a subsequent year, because of the way the NEA grants go. We won't find out until after, it'd be like next June, they'll announce this, so this would be for 2022 money. But you have to start somewhere. So you can't, you know, you always have to be planning ahead and planning ahead and planning ahead. So it's a 46-page, you know, request for, the rules themselves are 46 pages, so there's a lot that goes into this. Mm-hmm. So, you know, moving forward, and there's a lot of people that want to see this move forward. There's a lot of people that want to be in support of it. So we're continuing to move forward. We have not signed, I have not spent any more money out of my budget, as you directed. I don't know that I would have anyway, that we've already granted the money to them. So that's where that stands, but they still are planning ahead in case private funding comes in. No contracts have been signed with them for any performers or anything like that, because there's no money, there's not enough money for that. So that doesn't mean they won't continue planning for what could be a festival in 2021.
What I don't want to happen is we make commitments and then have to come back and say, now we really need money because now we're upside down, because that won't happen.
I am very clear on what your directive was.
Okay.
But that doesn't mean I'm not going to stop hoping that we can put something on for next year and in subsequent years as well, because there is a lot of enthusiasm for something like this in Carmel. And as any event planner knows, you can't just keep with what you're already doing. I mean, we've got a great lineup of events throughout the year. We've added things throughout the year. But I think anyone who's been around for 20 years knows that if we hadn't added those things in the last 20 years, then our appeal to new companies and new businesses and new residents would wane. So we always have to be doing something new and different. And even the events we have, we broaden them, we expand them, we do things differently. Each year we try and add a little something. How can we make it different? How can we make it more appealing? So adding events also helps us with our economic development as well, and it helps retain businesses and residents. It helps with economic development, as we all know. We all know the statistics about how much people spend money. It is an odd time to be trying to promote things, and aside from the festival, we all know that are we going to do, you know, this event or that event? And we're like, maybe. Yes, no. Yes, no. Yes, yes, we'll do it this way. And so this is a strange year to be trying to do something new like this, and I understand everyone's hesitation. I'm right there with you. But again, we can't just sit and wait and do nothing. So we're doing what we can do, and we're being optimistic about what we might be able to do in 2020. So 2021. Sorry.
I think I have two additional concerns related to your comments, and that is, one, it is an awkward time to be fundraising. A lot of organizations have said we're not going to be fundraising at this time, right? It's hard for our companies right now to, you know, to make changes to their physical workspace, to buy additional PPE, to add additional health people to their staff. Yet we're actively and aggressively fundraising, and I'm hoping it's not at the detriment to the Center for the Performing Arts and our other numerous arts organizations that are here in the community, because I guarantee you that pool that they're all fishing from is the same one, and there's fewer fish in there than there were before. And so I have great concern about that. Additionally, you had brought up business retention, and I'm so glad you did, because I'm worried about all of our efforts being, we're already such a heavy event-focused economic development strategy, but at what point does the basic tactics of checking with our businesses and understanding where they're, how they're growing and where they're shrinking and what their challenges are, and right now they have special challenges that they've never faced before. So what's our economic development strategy as it relates to business retention in the old basic blocking and tackling of economic development? I'm afraid that focusing on this festival, which is going to have huge impact on your department, as far as the amount of time they commit, is going to take away from those very important business retention opportunities as well.
Right. The difference between this festival and others is this is more like Chris Kindle Market than it is like the Art of Wine or another thing where it's my department that's running it. This is a separate not-for-profit. It is intended in subsequent years to make its own money, which is different than a lot of our other festivals that are reliant on the city 100%.
I think that's what's happened after year one, too. But certainly year one, you guys and the street department and the police department and the fire department and numerous other departments were all in on the Chris Kindle Market. And I can't
help but think
that that's the same thing for this one, year one and year two, if not beyond. Because, you know, again, when it comes to putting in this festival, I don't want police support, I don't want fire support, I don't want any of those dollars, because that's more dollars out of our department that's going to be overtime. And I don't think we're thinking far enough about this when we're saying we're still going to do it without council support. So I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other councilors? Any questions?
Madam President.
Councilor Ryder.
You and I have a great relationship, but I want to stand behind Sue on this, like we did last time. And I had not thought of the police and fire, because that is an expense that we use during the Chris Kindle Market. And if we put it on, there's no way to avoid that. So I would want the event to be able to pay for that, because they would be coming to us asking for more overtime if they didn't have the money. So, and normally the comment from the administration is, well, we pay for that for all the events, not for this one, because we've said don't spend any more city money for 21, for 21. Not saying never, we're saying for 21. So let's make sure we don't run into any additional overtime coming. Chief, are you hearing us? Don't come and ask for more overtime to cover that, because the answer will be no. Thank you. And that's not your fault, but you would have to do it.
All right. Any other questions? All right. Seeing none. Thank you, Nancy. Moving on to Old Business 12A, the 15th reading of Ordinance D-2488-19, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending Chapter 8, Article 6, Sections 8-56D and 8-58A. Sponsors are Councilors Finkham and Worrell. This was sent to the Finance, Utilities, and Rules Committee. And as Councilor Finkham mentioned, this will be discussed on July 8th. Item B, sixth reading of Ordinance D-2513-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending Chapter 4, Article 5, Section 4-98 of the Carmel City Code. Sponsor is Councillor Finkham, and this remains tabled. 13, public hearings. 13A is the first reading of Ordinance D2529-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, authorizing and approving an additional appropriation of funds from the General Fund Number 101 to the 2020 Carmel Police Department budget. Sponsors are Councillors Campbell, Finkham, Austin, Worrell, and Ryder.
Madam Chair.
Councillor Ryder.
Move to introduce.
We have a second.
A second.
And the synopsis on this is, you want that read, correct?
This was going to Councillor Finkham.
Oh, it can?
Oh, okay.
No,
well,
go
Councillor Ryder, go ahead. You can take it.
Okay. This ordinance authorizes and approves an additional appropriation of $632,191.31 from the general fund into the 2020 Carmel Police Department budget to pay for the additional school resource officers that were approved by the Carmel Clay Schools safety referendum. Basically, the money exists, the money's budgeted, and as you're hiring, as the police are hiring the officers, they're being reimbursed. Chief nodded his head yes, so I'm not sure you need to get out of your seat, but somebody might ask.
Yes. Chief, do you want to speak to this?
Good evening. Good to see everyone in person for a change. Jim Barlow, Carmel Police Department. Yes, the school had already issued a check to the city for that amount, and this is just placing it in each line item so that we can cover the costs incurred for hiring 4 officers.
Madam President.
Councilor Ryder. I have to have a public hearing.
Oh, first. Okay. I'm sorry.
Councilor Austin, do you have a question?
No.
Okay. Councilor Finkham.
Just to clarify for the public, this is to make this 100% whole, the cost for the officers.
Correct. It covers every item that a cost we incurred.
Okay. Thank you. I just wanted to hear you say that out loud
yes,
for the public.
Yes. So. The school covered every cost, yes.
Any other questions? Right.
I think, Madam President, just
So,
and can you clarify how many officers this is for? Because it's a phased approach.
Yes, this is for 4 officers that will actually start in the school this fall. So we've hired people that have been trained, released, and we have veteran officers that will take those positions that are identified and are actually getting training now.
Any other questions? Okay, then I will open the public hearing at 6:39:54. If you would like to speak for or against this ordinance, please approach the podium. Seeing no one, I will close the public hearing and I will entertain a motion.
Madam President.
Councilor Ryder.
Move to suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
All right, any discussion? Please vote. All right, this passes unanimously. So
move
we
to
have,
approve.
Thank you.
Second.
All right, any discussion? Again, please vote. And this passes unanimously. Thank you. Item 13B. The first reading of Ordinance D2530-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, authorizing and approving an additional appropriation of funds from the General Fund Number 101 to the Building Operations Fund Number 1208. Sponsor is Councillor Finkham.
Move to introduce.
Councillor Finkham.
Thank you. This ordinance authorizes and approves an additional appropriation of $140,640 from the general fund into the 2020 general administration budget to be used for other contracted service fees. And I'd like to just give a brief explanation and have Ashley Albrecht, our attorney, come on up, or Jim Kreider, director of administration, come up and discuss, what happened here. Jim's already up here. So, Jim, go ahead.
Well, good evening, everyone. Jim Kreider, Director of Administration. So about 2 years ago, we entered into an agreement with a company called Avenue Insights, and they do auditing, this kind of thing, and this is for a franchise fees that all the cable companies pay the city. So they pay the city about 5% of their gross annual receipts. This includes Metronet, Comcast, Charter, and AT&T. This particular one is for AT&T. And so we get a check from each of these organizations every quarter based on that formula. And there's really no way for us to know if the formula is correct or not, or if they're following it, so we do an audit or have an outside company do an audit to make sure that they're doing the right thing by the agreement that they have with the city. So we entered this agreement in August of 2018. The agreement included a $7,500 fixed rate that we would pay Avenue Insights, and then they would get 30% of whatever they discover. The objectives of the audit were, one, determine if the franchise fees had been properly calculated, two, verify all the appropriate revenues were included in the franchise fee calculation, and three, confirm the methodology for calculating and remitting the franchise fees. So we, after we entered into an agreement, the audit was initiated in August of 2018. It took about a year. There was a lot of things they had to look at, and they came up with, they believe the AT&T owed us $447,763 plus $111,939 in interest. This audit covered July of 2015 to June 30th of 2018, so right before we signed the contract. So that's over a three-year period. So shockingly, AT&T didn't just write us a check. So that's when the legal teams got involved, and there was some negotiation back and forth and discussion of the terms and agreements and whatever. And so at the end, based on our Corporation Council review and recommendation, the mayor elected to settle for $363,050. That settlement was agreed upon in writing in May of this year. And then about a month later, in June of this year, we got a check. So then I got the invoice for $140,000, and that's based on that formula. And so the only thing that's a little bit different is if you agree to settle, Avenue Insights gets 15% of, you know, the difference of what, so we, it's not their fault that we decided to settle. And so based on talking to them, over years past, other municipalities, you know, might settle for a really low number, then they've done 2 years of work and get, you know, get the short end of the stick, so to speak. So that's why they have this in there. And bottom line is we put $363,000 in the general fund, and this $140,000. All it is, I've already paid the invoice. All this does is reimburse that line that I paid it from so that I can, you know, we didn't know when this was going to be settled, so it wasn't appropriated initially. This just makes us even. And there's still $220,000 additional dollars in the general fund.
I'm going to ask Ashley to come up before we have questions.
Okay, sure.
Before we take questions for you, Jim, I want to have Ashley come up because I asked a question in email. So how do we prevent this from happening again? You know, what do we learn and how do we prevent this from happening again? And Ashley, to the extent that you can talk about it, can you give the council just a little bit of flavor on that?
Sure. Welcome back to City Hall. I'm Ashley Albrecht. I'm the Carmel City Attorney. And I am a little limited on what I can speak on tonight because we are still in the middle of negotiations with another provider. However, what I can say is that the issue with AT&T was that they were disputing a portion of the costs, and it was a business decision to move forward with the settlement agreement. And then we, with that settlement agreement, we solidified what they would and would not pay going forward. And all in all, by the agreement that we accepted, we will be able to, in perpetuity, regain much more in franchise fees moving forward. So if that helps a little bit in your understanding of why any fees may have been waived, that was our thought process behind that.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions for me?
Any other questions?
And I could add too, it might help a little bit to understand that the dispute was over a 1987 franchise fee agreement. And I think we all can understand that, I think everyone in this room was in a different position 1987 than we are now. Similarly speaking, the law has changed since 1987, and the primary part of the law that has changed is the fact that back then, municipalities were able to negotiate those franchise fees directly with each provider. Now the providers are statewide, and they are regulated by the IURC. So that played into a lot of our decision as well, that some of the language in the 1987 agreement, as you can imagine, the receivers were a little different back then than they are now. A receiver is an instrument that brings the cable into your home and then into your TV. So all in all, our decision to move forward, look forward thinking, really helped the city solidify the costs going forward.
Okay. No other questions?
Madam President.
Councilor Finkham.
Move to suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
All right, we have a motion. Oh, I have to have a public hearing. That's right. I am going to open the public hearing at 6:48. If you would like to speak for or against, please step forward to the microphone. Seeing no one stepping forward, I will close the public hearing at 6:48 and 17 seconds. Now I'll entertain a motion.
Move to suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Okay.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? Please vote.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All right. Please vote. All right. This passes unanimously. All right. Item 13C. First reading of Ordinance Z652-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending the Silvara PUD District Ordinance. Sponsor is Councilor Ryder.
Move to introduce.
Second.
Councilor Ryder.
This ordinance seeks PUD amendment and commitment amendment approval to update certain standards associated with the Silvara PUD Ordinance in order to create a unique European village design with ancillary carriage garages for Exmoor at Jackson's Grant. And I know the petitioner's here. Pop on up there, please. This came out of Plan Commission, sent this to the committee and gave committee approval. So it had a lot of support going to committee, but we wanted to go through the details. After going through the details, the committee approved this unanimously. On to send it to council with a positive recommendation unanimously.
All right. Thank you.
Good evening, members of the council. For the record, my name is Steve Harden. I'm a partner in the law firm of Fagery Drinker here in Carmel. With me from Republic Development is Mr. Larry Moon and Mr. Doug Wagner. About 10 years ago, we were here for Republic's very first project in Carmel. It was called Silvara back then. Now it's known as Jackson's Grant. So at that time, there wasn't a track record of the quality and character of the development that Republic was going to deliver. But hopefully, as we've gone through the process here with Exmoor and through the Plan Commission process and staff, most everyone that we've talked to has said that they were thankful and congratulate Republic for over-delivering on the promises that were made 10 years ago for this project. And we're back tonight for the Exmoor, and I'm not sure if the technology back there will show this, if I can get them to... Ah, perfect. Thank you so much. So this is an outline in blue of Jackson's Grant. If you might remember, any of you that were here when we were looking at this before, the intersection of 116th and Spring Mill is right down here in this area. And then Jackson's Grant has the stable site area here, the hamlet area here. These are townhomes. This is an empty nester neighborhood. These two areas in the middle then are price points in the mid-700s. And then as we get back up in here to Westvale, these homes are in about the $1 million range. And then Northvale is expected to be even higher than that $1 million average price point. In between those two is an empty nester neighborhood called Exmoor. And Exmoor will include, Exmoor will include 22 lots that are shown here on the concept plan. And the reason we're here
is because that the plan that Republic would like to be able to offer the citizens here in Carmel would be these European cottage-style homes. These are expected to run from $800,000 to $1.5 million, with probably an average around $1 million. Not only will the architecture and design be unique for the area, but they're also planning to offer carriage garages. You can see those in your packets as well. These are going to, the European-style homes are intended to purposely be smaller in scale. They're going to be probably between 3,000 and 4,500 square feet, but the idea is to not have a three, four, five-story garage or four-story or four-car garage with those homes that we were just showing you. And so some of the folks that are empty nesters that would be moving into the neighborhood might have a desire for additional storage for an additional vehicle, a man or woman cave upstairs. These are two-story carriage garages. You can see a little person up here on the second floor. So there will be, these are, the dimensions are in here. These are 14 by 46. So those are pretty good sized square footages for the storage of vehicles or other things, as well as the use on the upstairs area as well. The amendment is intended to be able to allow this development to happen. The main issue is that we're the, we'll go back to the concept plan. Main issue is this is unique in Carmel to offer these carriage garages. They will be in a common area. These are private streets back here. And so this whole area will be a common area, and then within the common area will be these carriage garages right there. When we met with the planning department staff, they liked the idea. They thought this was really creative and unique. Kind of scratched their heads along with us about how do we actually write this to say that it's okay from a technical writing perspective. And so we had to do the amendment, which has been presented to you now, to allow carriage garages in the common areas, as well as updating a couple of the standards for the setbacks for these carriage homes that we're proposing. I think as we heard at the introduction, there was no remonstrance at the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission, as they do, referred it to their committee, giving them full approval authority, and it was out of the committee in one meeting back to you with a unanimous favorable recommendation. So we're here this evening asking for your support and approval, and we'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Madam President.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Ryder.
To add to that just a little bit that will clarify a few things for council, something that has come up in the time that I've spent on Planning Commission and you spent on Planning Commission, private streets always give me heartburn because 10, 15 years down the road when they need maintenance, the neighborhood comes to us and says, please take over our streets. And in the past, they've built them less than city standards. We don't allow that anymore. One of the first things I said to him when you said private streets was city standards, correct? And he said yes. So if for some reason down the road they would come to us, it would at least, we wouldn't have to upgrade the level of construction. And as far as the extra garages, they cannot be rentals. They cannot even be livable. They're not, you can put a half bath or something. They're not made to be a rented space or an additional living space of the home. They are meant to be garages with possibly a man or woman cave, as you
That's
said.
Correct.
Councilor Ryder or Mr. Hardin, I did have that question about rentals. So what is ensuring that these can't become rentals?
Well, I suppose it's the same question that would be, why couldn't I rent my own garage currently today? So these are going to be, they're in the common area. So when someone wants to own one, they will get a 99-year lease is the way that will work. And there's no, they're not habitable, so they're not able to be a living unit. So I don't think that there'd be any issue. I don't think we've
Well, no, in terms of renting to somebody who wants to store a car there.
Oh, we didn't address that, and I'm not sure we were looking to. I think if you want to rent a garage to your friend to put a car in it, I'm not sure that's our business to get into. We don't want them to become rentals as inhabitable units, I think is the bigger deal. At least we didn't question that. So
sure. Okay.
Not to say we couldn't.
We have thought about that, though. I'm sorry, Larry Moon with Republic Development. We will have restrictions in the declarations that say that they can, they're, like Steve said, a long-term lease that goes to the homeowners association. So they will have technical ownership, but that unit owner who pays to build it will then have it for the long term. They cannot lease it to anyone else who is not an Exmoor resident. So, for example, they could, there's only 15 garage places, there are 22 lots, so we're assuming not everyone's going to have one. But someone, if they, for whatever reason, didn't want it anymore, they could sell their lease to, or lease it to one of the other residents. But it would have to be an Exmoor resident. It couldn't even be another resident in an adjoining Jackson's Grant sub-neighborhood.
Oh, it couldn't be? Okay, because no. I had that question. Yeah. Okay.
And one thing I do want to point out, from the beginning of this, there are certain companies that we deal with, and I made this statement at Plan Commission also, and Republic, from the start to the end of this, and you were part of the start of it at Plan Commission, from the beginning to the end of this, and I think you also, Bruce, that they've delivered more than they promised. It was an undersell, overdeliver. So I have a lot of confidence in what they'll do in this development.
Any other questions? Councillor Finkham?
Can you clarify, Steve, I know when you introduced this, you said, hey, if you want a man cave or a woman cave, and I appreciate the neutral gender of the cave, is that occupancy? Well, how is that defined? Because I didn't see a definition for it, and I just don't know the answer to that.
What was the question?
So they can have it as to watch a football game upstairs, but they, if it's not occupancy,
they want
you to stay. Nope. Again, it'll be written into the declaration, no overnight stays, no full baths, no full kitchens. They can put a microwave up there. They can have a refrigerator, pool table, things like that. But they cannot stay in it overnight.
Okay, so
that's occupancy, yeah. So it couldn't be lived in, per se.
Councillor Worrell.
Yes. How is maintenance of those common area garages handled?
It will be a separate assessment, which we have now in Jackson's Grant, for example, the Hamlet, which are townhomes. They're part of the master association, so they get the master bill, but then the townhomes have a sub-association. That will be the same way this will work. So if you're a lessee of the units, there will be a separate bill. You will maintain the inside, and the association will maintain the outside of the units.
Okay. So we won't get into a situation where one person's not taking care of that garage door.
Right. Exteriors will all be maintained, very similar to townhomes, where they're all maintained. Maintained by the association.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. Seeing none, I will open the public hearing at 6:59 and 41 seconds. If you would like to speak for or against this ordinance, please step forward. Seeing no one, I am closing the public hearing at 6:59 and 57 seconds.
Madam President.
Councillor Ryder.
Due to the lack of remonstrance at Plan Commission and City Council and kind of lack of questions and lack of information I think we would derive from sending this to committee, I would move to suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
All right. Thank you, Councillor Kimball. Any discussion? Councillor Hannon.
I just wanted to hear from Councillor Green whether he thinks that's appropriate. I mean, I do appreciate certainly that it went to subcommittee, no remonstrance, unanimous vote, but I just want to hear from Tony whether he thinks it's appropriate to not send it to council or to a committee.
Councillor Green.
Yeah, I'll be requesting or we can have the vote, but that it go to land use. To give the people of Jackson Grant one more opportunity to speak on it.
I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay. Councillor Austin?
I know that they have another proposal that has not yet to reach council. Do you plan to look at both of them simultaneously in land and use just to save their time? And
possibly. Depends on the timing. I think, is the next one coming?
It should be coming
to the next
meeting.
City. It didn't make this agenda, but yeah.
Okay. All right. So I will send this to land use for further discussion.
I do want to reiterate, Madam President.
Yes, Councillor
Ryder.
I do
want to reiterate, literally nobody showed up to have any opinion or indifferent. There was no remonstrance at all. So thank you.
All right, thank you. Moving on to number 14, new business. Item A, resolution CC 07-06-20-01. A resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, certain matters in connection with the integrated 126th Street Corridor Economic Development Area, also known as the Corner Allocation Area. Sponsor is Councilor Worrell.
Madam President.
Can I get a...
Move to introduce.
Move to introduce.
Second.
Thank you. Councilor Worrell.
All right. So this project is the 116th and Range Line project. It has already gone through land use. This is really a technicality to create the allocation area for it. The reason that it was not brought with the rest of the packet or with the bond situation was because of timing. That's really all it was. They could not get the documents prepared. So this is to extend the allocation area. Director Mesteski is here if anyone has any questions, or I'm happy to answer them as well.
Any questions from council?
I move to suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Madam President.
Councilor Finkham.
It's a resolution, so we can
Okay, thank you. So would you like to make a motion to
move to approve?
Second.
All right, any discussion? Please vote. All right, this passes unanimously. Item 14B, first reading of Ordinance D-2531-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending Section 8-48 of the Carmel City Code. Sponsors are Councilors Finkham and Worrell.
Second.
All right, Councilor Worrell.
So I'm dealing with all the technicalities tonight. This was, we've already addressed this ordinance in the Land Use Committee regarding parking near Firehouse Condos. Unfortunately, I'll call it Scribner's, but it wasn't Scribner, but there was just an oversight in getting the amendment that had been previously discussed into the packet when we voted. So we are now going to have John Oberlander come up and fill us in on that amendment, and we're just starting over from scratch.
Good evening, councilors. John Oberlander, Assistant Corporation Counsel. So this just makes a slight amendment to the parking ordinance that was approved by the council, as Councilor Worrell said at the last meeting. It does make a substantive change, though, so we couldn't say that it was a Scrivener's error, and that is in the time. So if you look at the time, instead of noon, it is 9 a.m. for the parking restriction. But none of the spots have changed. It's just the time.
Okay. Any questions from council?
Madam President.
Councilor Worrell.
I would like to suggest that we suspend the rules and go ahead and vote on this minor change tonight.
Any discussion? Okay. Please vote. The rules have been suspended. Councilor Worrell.
Madam President. So, John, can you just clarify for council, everybody's been notified of this change. There won't be any surprises to any of the tenants. Did we dot our I's and cross our T's?
Yes, everybody's been made aware.
Okay. Thank you.
Did you make a motion to approve?
No, I didn't yet.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All right, please vote. All right, the vote is unanimous. Yes, we did. We did suspend the rules. Thank you. All right, moving on to resolution CC 07-06-20-02, a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, reaffirming the city's commitment to excellence in policing. Sponsors are Councilors Finkham, Campbell, Austin, Green, Hannon, Kimball, Nelson, Ryder, and Worrell.
Move to introduce.
All right, Councilor Finkham.
Thank you. This resolution reaffirms the City of Carmel's commitment to what we put in this ordinance as the way we police, and that is excellence in policing, which includes transparency, accountability, and the incorporation and practice of the core values of honesty, compassion, honor, integrity, loyalty, and professionalism. I'm going to read this resolution so it's very clear what we're proposing here this evening and that we're all behind. And I'm really proud of the fact that all of us are sponsors on this resolution tonight. I think it goes to show our support for our police department and the way we police and the way we interact with our community. And it also goes to the fact that we feel that this is a really important issue that we need to address in our community loudly and with passion. The events of the past few weeks have been very upsetting for everybody in our community here as well as across the nation, and I don't need to underscore what we've seen on TV and the responses to such, both nationally and in our own backyard. With that has come calls for our community to do more. And I really want to make sure that the public knows, and all of us do by sponsoring this resolution, that we are committed to, as a resolution reads, excellence in policing, and that we are going to hold ourselves and our police department to those high standards. And what I'm proud to say is, learning more about these items ourselves, I've been really, really pleased to learn that we've been ahead of the game in a lot of these areas. And I'll have the chief come up here and talk more about that here in a moment. But I want to make sure that our community understands that they have the full support of this council and the administration in ensuring that our community is treated with the respect that it deserves. So I'd like to read the resolution here and then invite the chief to come up and talk about a few of the items here. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana is committed to ensuring that the Carmel Police Department continues to manifest excellence in policing as a highly professional and respectful law enforcement agency, resolute in keeping the persons and properties of all city residents, businesses, visitors safe and secure. And whereas the council acknowledges and shares in the pain and anger that's felt across our nation as a result of the appalling and unjustified treatment of George Floyd while in the custody of officers of the Minneapolis Police Department. And whereas the council is aware that in some communities, this and other instances involving police officers have caused our residents to lose faith in their law enforcement personnel. And whereas the council also acknowledges that there are many often unrecognized and underappreciated men and women who daily put on a uniform and badge and leave their loved ones to honorably, respectfully, and selflessly serve and protect their communities. And whereas the council wishes to both support our city's law enforcement personnel and to help maintain, and in some cases, rebuild a confident and trusting relationship between our police officers and the public they serve by now reaffirming our city's commitment to excellence in policing. Whereas excellence in policing includes the practice of transparency and accountability, and at its heart, the promotion of the core values of honesty, compassion, honor, integrity, loyalty, and professionalism. And whereas the Carmel Police Department has already taken numerous initiatives in furtherance of its practice of EIP, excellence in policing, including but not limited to membership and accreditation by the Commission of Accreditation for Law Enforcement Agencies, which you'll hear us call CALEA occasionally, publishing an annual use of force report / analysis, training its officers in the use of de-escalation techniques, employing in-car cameras and body cams, recruiting female officers and officers of color, offering citizens and teen police academies to educate and engage our community, and assigning school resource officers to our public schools to help build trust and understanding in and between our students and our police officers. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, as follows. The foregoing recitals are incorporated herein by this reference. Whenever possible, the practice of excellence in policing within the Carmel Police Department should include, but not be limited to, the following. A, standardized training for all officers in the use of de-escalation to avoid the use of force whenever possible. B, membership and accreditation by the Commission of Accreditation for Law Enforcement Agencies. C, the publishing of an annual use of force report and analysis. D, the use of in-car and body cameras. E, the recruitment of women and persons of color. F, the continuation of the Citizens and Teen Police Academies. G, the assignment of school resource officers to Carmel schools. H, the engagement in open and meaningful community dialogue. I, the maintenance of a practice of transparency and accountability. And J, the promotion of the core values of honesty, compassion, honor, integrity, loyalty, and professionalism. And this resolution shall become effective upon its passage and execution by the Common Council and the mayor as required by law. I'm really proud of the men and women who serve our community and wear the Carmel Police Department badge each and every day, who put themselves in harm's way potentially every day, every time they get called out on a run, and the families that support them at home and in other states and communities. And I know that this city council is very much behind our police department and feels the same way, as evidenced by the sponsorship on this resolution. I do want to say we did run this by our Commission on Human Relations, the Mayor's Commission on Human Relations. We received one person responding back and really addressed some more national issues than what those are that impact our community, and didn't really see any needs to make changes in this resolution result. The chief is also going to talk about a new policy that I believe goes into effect today, sir, that also addressed a couple of the points that the one writer had recommended. Lastly, I want to say that the chief was very open to two other things that we've been talking about in previous meetings, and that was continuing diversity and inclusion training that the police department has already led for the city on. That's relevant to what police officers do, not the same as civilians might get. And also, we had discussed holding community use of force training and educational opportunities. I mentioned at a previous council meeting, I believe, that we as a council got to spend some time with the police department in December and better understand use of force training and de-escalation techniques. And he's agreed, the chief has agreed, to make those open to the public. And so we'll be working on some dates and putting out some information that people can sign up and participate. And I highly encourage that. It was educational, I believe, speaking for all of us, to sit through that. And that'll allow also our police department and men and women who are teaching those to also hear back from our community and what's important to them as a result of that training. So, Chief, with the Madam President's permission, I would like you to talk from the heart about this resolution and also the new policy that's going to be taking place. Chief.
Thank you. Jim Barlow, Carmel Police Department. And again, thank you for your support and allowing us to participate in this process. I think as a police department, our growth in being professional is an ongoing thing, just like our policies are living documents. And I just want to maybe hit a couple of points and then answer any questions you may have. But like point A, we talk about standardized training on de-escalation. We've incorporated de-escalation and scenario training in our yearly, multiple times a year, whether it's defensive tactics, firearms, or driving training now for many years. And I think that it helps us if you look at our use of force. And as a living document, our use of force, we looked at it after a lot of these events, and some of the issues that were that we did the training and we do in practice, we thought it'd be good to put into our policy. It makes sense to put in policy, and like all of our policies, we're always changing them. And some of the things we added were de-escalation, intervention, something we've been teaching officers to intervene if an officer is overly involved in a situation. Is that it's our duty as it's always been in our rules and regulations, but we thought let's make it clear in our use of force. And we've added that along with clarifying a big hot topic is the chokehold. And this policy clearly defines what a chokehold is. It is still allowed in our policy under deadly force situations. And if you have further questions on that, I'd be happy to explain what that means. So, but basically, if I have a level of force that I can shoot someone to defend myself, I can use an impact tool, a nightstick. I can use a rock on the side of the road if I'm in a ditch fighting for my life. It doesn't make sense to restrict anything because we don't know what the officer will be facing. But that is a deadly force issue only. It's not something, if someone is a, we call a passive resistor, so they're not cooperating, that is not a technique that would be used by in any fashion. And so we want to protect the community. We also want to restrict our officers and if unfortunately they're faced with a deadly force situation. I think another thing we're talking about, CALEA, which is the accreditation agency. As you know, the Attorney General has been tasked now to look at, they want to get the whole country accredited, which is an important thing. And they're looking at CALEA as this organization that we're already participating in since 1996. And I think you guys had a chance to meet the assessors. It's an ongoing process. It's not that we can't just say we're doing things. They come in and make sure we're doing what we're saying. To put things in scope, where I'm all for law enforcement reform, there's only 5% of agencies in this country are accredited. 5%. 21 in the state of Indiana. So there is needs. Councilman Finkman talked about the national look, and I think there's a look at nationally at law enforcement. But I think it's important to also look at law enforcement individually and what are each agency doing to get better and to do a good job. And I think being part of CALEA ensures us, it gives us those policies, those documents to make us better. Another thing we're doing when you talk about publishing our use of force, we're looking at, we just purchased a software that's going to make all our policies public facing. And because they're living documents, we could put all our policies out there, but just like this policy, we probably have three or four changes in the last year and a half. Laws change, case laws change. So we're constantly changing those documents. So once we get this up and running, people can go to our website and look at each one of our policies, because I think it's important that people see that. We're also looking at looking with the agency, Fishers is doing this too, to make ability for people to look at like our use of force, maybe our pursuits and some of those things in real time. As they occur, they can look at year to date, what's happened in the last week. So in an effort to be transparent, we're again constantly changing, moving. So we're just not happy to be where we're at. We want to be better each and every day. And I think these things we're doing are moving for that. We're not perfect, but we strive for perfection. So I just wanted to cover a couple of those bullets, and then maybe if you guys have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
All right. Any questions from council? Councilor Ryder.
Madam President. Questions, no. Comments about the document, yes. Start with the accreditation. You go above and beyond. I always say how our police department is proactive, not reactive. It's why we like living here. I'm 100% behind what we're writing here, but I want to make sure that our officers understand how we feel, or at least how I feel, and I'm sure other people will agree. You did a training for the council. I forget what you called it. You brought us down, and you were the bad guy, and I actually got the pleasure of shooting you. And the decision to do that was split second. I mean, I had ridden with guys before, but I knew it was fake, but the adrenaline and that split second decision, whether you were going to do something bad or good, I can't imagine making that decision in real life. I don't want anything that's going on in the world right now or anything that we write to get our officers to slow down that decision, because they won't go home alive to their family. They need to use their training, which we use the best. We're top in the state, in the country. You go all the way. Use the training. We do it for a reason. Do not slow down your decisions. Like you said, the chokehold is so negative, not if it's saving your life. Not if it's the last thing you have to do. I don't want our officers to think we are not going to support them in saving their life. And that's not what this is. This is a public statement saying that we want things to happen. But I think they're already happening here. And so does this is not saying it's not. The council does too. This is us backing it up. And you're already doing it. We're going public with it. Don't slow down your thinking. You're trained well. Go home alive every night. Thank you.
Councilor Royal.
Thank you, Madam President. Chief, I know that there have been some requests for meetings from some of the groups that are out there. I was wondering if you could fill us in as much as you can without saying anything that should not be disclosed publicly, but could you share with us, I don't know that you've had any meetings yet, but there are some on the books, I know, and if you can just tell us anything about that.
Yes, I've met briefly a couple weeks ago with one organization here in Carmel, and we have a follow-up meeting next week, next Thursday. I'm hopeful. I think it's good. I think it's important for us as a police department to be open to other people's views, ideas, and learn. It keeps our minds thinking, too. And we're just hopeful that also they'll understand and take the time to learn about us. And that's the point I'll reiterate. We do ride-alongs. We have a Citizens Academy. We're going to have this. I'll get some dates to the council on some of these mini academies on use of force. And I think it's important. We try to learn about everybody that's part of our community. I think it's important. But I think it's also important for people to get to know what we do and what our job's like. And I think there's a lot of avenues to do that, including, again, right along Citizens Academy. And so I encourage the public, I encourage everyone to take advantage of that, because I think that when you'd learn about the officers and who they are, I think you guys see them, but you're pretty amazed at what kind of quality people we have here. And so, yeah, we look forward to it. I think that it's important to have good discussions where two or more people get together and have an open conversation and be open-minded. And I look forward to next week and any group that would like to talk to us about the job we do.
I highly recommend the Citizens Academy. I went through that 10 years ago, and it was fantastic. Really good experience. So I recommend anybody watching to sign up for it. And when is the next sign up for the Academy?
The next one is full, but it'll be this fall. So if they go to our website, they can sign up for the spring session. It's 10 weeks long, one day a week, 3 hours a night, 2.5 to 3 hours, depending on how many questions you get asked. But it's been a very warmly welcomed. I think people enjoy it a lot. So thank you for the plug.
Councillor Austin? Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Councillor Worrell.
The reason for me asking that question is, anecdotally, I know that we have an ERG group, and I am familiar with a couple of those officers who have had ongoing dialogues with the organizations who are protesting and raising questions. And I think that's really, I was very impressed with it. Number one, they're on a first name basis. It's not always at the chief level. It is at a level below. And I think that's really important. I want to applaud you for allowing that, making it happen, et cetera. And then also just to point out under section two of this is the engagement in open and meaningful community dialogue. So that was a real high priority for me in this resolution.
And I agree, and I appreciate you pointing it out, because I think that, again, we're the community is our customers. And not only Carmel citizens, but people who come here, work, play, visit, are all our customers. And if we're not listening to what their needs are, what their concerns are, then we can't do an effective job. So, I think our event response group, I'll take a moment just to brag on them. They have great relationships, and credit to a lot of the protesters. They've reached out and wanted to do a professional protest, and they've reached out to us to help coordinate. And I think that our folks are trained in that. It's not all shields and clubs. It's about building relationships and working with, because ultimately our job is to provide a safe environment for people to speak their minds.
Now, Councillor Austin.
Oh, thank you, Madam President. I wanted to thank Councillor Finkham for kind of taking the lead on this. We're seeing police departments across the country where officers are deciding that having to put up with kind of what they're putting up with, that they don't want to continue with the job, taking early retirement, and it's going to have an effect on some police departments. So I think it's important that we show the respect to our police department, and I think that Carmel does that. I do want to note an incident. Recently, we saw some vandalism to a statue in Carmel of the police officer at Main Street and the Monon, where there was red paint right there. And it disheartened many people. Luckily, it was cleaned up very quickly by our street department, so I thank them there. Shortly after that, I know that you put, some officers put an American flag on that statue to kind of show their support. But I did see one thread on social media, and I hesitate to even mention something on social media, but I will because it's important, where people saw the flag and our support of our police as somehow a passive-aggressive response to people's freedom of protest or opposing racism. And, you know, I support this resolution. I think it's very well written. We got to make it clear, because some people are trying to divide us, that you can oppose racism, you can support freedom of speech, and support our police. The idea that it's an either-or scenario is ridiculous. It's not either-or. You can support police and oppose racism. I think this resolution strikes the perfect tone where it's kind of trying to unite us instead of divide us. So I thank you for that, Councillor Finkham.
Thank you. Councillor Hannon?
Chief, thank you for being here. Certainly behind this. One of the things that I would say that actually I appreciated in the fall and then with recent events is it's very easy when we come under criticism to just recoil and be defensive. You know, whether you're a cop or in healthcare or military or anything. And so rather than saying, look, we do all these things and we have all these policies and we're part of a accredited organization, what you've been careful to say both in the past and I think recently is we're continually striving to get better. And I think that's the most important thing, and I commend you for that. I'm very glad to hear that as you said, that your policies are a living document and you continue to update them. Again, which I think is excellent, making those available to the public is even better. You know, that transparency is sort of the best deflection of, I think, unwarranted criticism. And I would encourage you to continue along, you know, H here is community outreach. It's very easy to socialize as cops and say, hey, we're doing everything right. It's very easy and very comfortable when people pat us on the back and say, hey, you're doing a good job. It's the uncomfortable conversations with people who do not agree with us, who have differences of opinion and different perspectives. Those are the ones that are very, very difficult, but incredibly, incredibly important to get better. And I think you recognize that. I just wanted to reaffirm that. I think your close relationship with the Council on Human Relations is a part of that. But I would also encourage you to reach out to those who are critical, as long as they're interested in a constructive dialogue, because that's how we get better. So thank you very much.
Any other comments or questions? We are working with a resolution.
Madam President.
Councillor Finkham.
I want to sum up just by saying thank you. You know, there's a Lombardi quote about, you know, perfection isn't attainable, but if you chase it, you can catch excellence. And I think that's what we see the culture is here, and thank you for striving, reaching for that. With that, I'd like to make the motion to approve this resolution.
Second.
All right, any further discussion? Please vote. And this passes unanimously. Thank you, Chief, for being here. Item 14D, first reading of Ordinance D-2533-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, adding Chapter 2, Article 1, Section 2-9.4 to the Carmel City Code. Sponsors are Councilors Campbell, Worrell, and Austin.
Motion to introduce.
Second.
Councillor Austin.
Thank you, Madam President. So this is giving the city the ability to close city-owned theaters, such as the Center of Performing Arts, in the instance of another outbreak. And I'm going to invite Jeff McDermott up to kind of explain how that would work and how that process would go.
Thank you, Councillor.
And thank you, Council. Jeff McDermott. I'm president and CEO of the Center for the Performing Arts and the Great American Songbook Foundation. This ordinance, as proposed, might seem counterintuitive, why we would be asking for this council to support the ability for the city to shut us down. But in fact, that is what we are doing for very specific reasons. We obviously are stewards of these great venues and are responsible for the safety of the people that come into our venues. We book many, many artists from literally all over the world and have any number of situations where in a setting like this with the current pandemic, we may need to actually be required to shut down. We haven't faced that yet, and we hope we won't face it. But I know the attorneys in the room understand force majeure clauses and know that for years and years and years, force majeure clauses have been placed in contracts with little thought to them. I've now had the pleasure of reading dozens and dozens of force majeure clauses and have found that they run the gamut and are all over the board in terms of what might be included in them. Sometimes pandemics, epidemics are included in them. Often they are not. Always included in a force majeure clause is the ability to have both parties go back to their corners and break the contract if a government entity shuts down a venue. So one of the things that we want to be able to do, and what we have seen around the country, some artists around the country have been challenging force majeure clauses because they are not specific enough. And that is something that we don't want to face. Our goal would be to always have the ability, if there is a situation where we feel it is unsafe to open our venues, we feel it's unsafe to bring patrons into our venues, but an artist is insisting under a contract that they have a right to perform and to be paid, we want the ability to be able to say no. And in fact, there is a provision within the city ordinances that permits the government to shut it down so that we can make the more reasoned decision. I go back to March 12th, I think, when Governor Holcomb issued his first executive order, and that day we actually had the U.S. Army Band and Soldiers Chorus literally loading into our venues at the time that that order was issued. We went to them and explained to them the order that was issued. They very reasonably packed up and left. It was the only reasonable option for us to make and the only reasonable option for them. And we have been blessed that we have had to postpone, suspend dozens and dozens of programs, not only for ourselves, but for our resident companies, we have not had any problems to date with artists who have come in trying to challenge that. This is purely a preventative measure in the event that we were to have an artist who would try to challenge that. We have seen that happen at venues elsewhere around the country. We've been fortunate not to have that, but our goal is to make sure that we never have to face that and have a backup plan. I'm happy to take any questions as to what our motivation is behind this.
Any questions from council? Councillor Austin?
It says in here, and maybe you're giving Sandy legal, that it was expire on its own terms, extended from, I don't see an expiration date. Would we? I'm just wondering if we would ever have to renew this.
My understanding, I believe Corporation Counsel Doug Haney drafted this. My understanding is that it would not have to be renewed.
Okay. It would not have to be.
Again, I think the goal here, this would be used sparingly, only as necessary, and in cooperation between an arts venue and the city.
And I did just want to point out that the mayor will give 24 hours notice to council before exercising this power. And also the common council, by a majority vote of five or more, can rescind this order as well, any order as well. Doug, are you wanting to speak?
Actually, Councillor, I was a little bit cavalier on that statement about the expire by its own terms. That was in an early draft when I actually had written in a drop-dead provision. It doesn't hurt to keep it in, but I just want to explain why it was in there, since there's nowhere else in here that talks about an expiration date. I think it's surplusage in the final draft, which is before you, but it doesn't hurt anything. So I just wanted to give you kudos for your second year law school, which you've just passed by finding this. If the council wanted to strike that, they could, but again, I don't think it's necessary to do so. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Okay. Councilor Ryder?
Yes, I would move we suspend the rules and act on this this evening.
All right, do I have a second?
Second.
All right, any discussion? Please vote. Okay, the rules have been suspended and
move
we are
to approve.
Voting on it.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All right, this passes unanimously without Councillor Finkham. She is not present. Okay, thank you. Item 14E, first reading of, all right, we're at 2532, right? Jacob? Okay. First reading of Ordinance D-2532-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending Chapter 8, Article 3, Sections 8-22 and 8-24 of the Carmel City Code. Sponsors are Councilors Campbell, Ryder, and Worrell. Can I get a motion?
Move to introduce.
Second.
All right, thank you. I will take this one. This ordinance regulates the speed of motor vehicles on 131st Street, also known in part as Main Street, from Boone County Line to Clay Center Road. And this came about starting last year. The HOA board for Hadley Grove, which is just on the north side of 131st/Main, they contacted me last year with concerns about speeding along 131st Street, just west of Town Road. Jeremy Cashman, our city engineer, conducted a traffic study and recommended a reduction of the speed limit from 45 miles an hour to 40, which would be from the Boone County line, and then this would create some consistency east of Town Road to bring that in line, you know, for 40 miles an hour. And also a crosswalk with flashing beacons is going to be going in as well over by the CVS, which is just south of Hadley Grove, so that, you know, as traffic has increased because of additional retail in the area, there have been more people walking, which we want a walkable city. So with that, if you have any questions, Benjamin is here as well, and Jeremy Cashman. Benjamin, do you want to speak about this?
Sure. So I have a little diagram or handy-dandy exhibit here. If I can move it up, just to kind of explain what our current situation is. So we have from Clay Center Road to Town Road, 40 miles an hour, and then we have from Town Road to the Boone County line, 45 miles an hour. That's the current situation. What this ordinance does is it creates uniformity along that whole line and makes it all 40 miles an hour.
Any questions from council? Councilor Kimball?
I just wanted to make the comment that I'm very supportive of this. With the amount of people walking, pedestrians and bicyclists, but we're also seeing what we call micromobility coming to our city, and that's low-speed vehicles. Lowering the speed limit, we all get emails constantly about speeding in our neighborhood streets, and this is definitely a step in the right direction.
Any other comments? Councilor Ryder?
You know where
I'm going.
You
had your microphone on.
I'm going. Without objection, I would move we suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
Any discussion? Please vote. Okay. The rules are suspended, and we will be acting on this.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any further discussion? All right. Please vote. And this passes unanimously. We're moving on to item F, first reading of Ordinance D-2534-20, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, adding Chapter 6, Article 4, Section 6-63, Subsection M, and Chapter 6, Article 4, Section 6-73, to the Carmel City Code. Sponsors are Councilors Kimball, Campbell, and Ryder.
Move to introduce.
Second.
Councilor Kimball.
Yes, this ordinance prohibits loitering in the public parking garages and parking lots and prohibits the riding of bicycles on certain city sidewalks. I think we'll have our legal counsel come.
Doug Haney, Corporation Counsel. This was drafted because of concerns, first of all, about persons congregating in parking garages and parking lots for purposes other than for which the structures were built, which was to park, so people can then take advantage of the amenities of our city. It's not meant to eat in, it's not meant to sleep in, it's not meant to read in. Parking garages and parking lots are not public forums, fora. They're structures for a specific purpose. And not only that, our parking garages are not structurally made for being full of vehicles and large crowds all at the same time. They're made just for vehicles. And this ordinance, as I've drafted it, avoids constitutional issues of vagueness. It reiterates the fact that there's no First Amendment forum being created by these structures. And it simply allows us to avoid the to make parking spaces available and to avoid the litter and the congestion and the, in some cases, intimidation, the limits on pedestrians being and cars being able to safely drive and walk through the facilities. It makes clear that these structures are meant for what they were built for, and only that. And that's my synopsis.
Questions from council? Councilor Finkham?
I also want to briefly discuss the part about prohibition of bicycle riding on certain city sidewalks. I guess technically there are a couple previous constituents, because they're now in the area that's represented by Councilor Kimball, reach out to me. And one had been dining at an outside restaurant and had someone riding a bike fall over onto their table, dumping margaritas, which is a total waste of margarita, onto them. Luckily, no one was hurt. But also then another individual had said that two bikers came rolling through in a 45-minute period during a lunch period as well. And so we're trying to make sure we have a safe situation for that as well. So someone doesn't inadvertently back up a chair into a cyclist and someone gets hurt. So,
Councilor Austin.
Thank you, Madam President. As a business owner on Main Street, I can attest this isn't just a few bikes every now and again. This is happening on a regular basis. We've been there 10 years, and it's always been an issue. I've talked to Mr. Calabrese at Old Town Tavern. I would hope that we could suspend the rules and act on this evening. And I also will say publicly, I hope we get signage and some enforcement of this law. And I really hope we get some signage, because without that, not everyone's going to know that these laws exist. So I hope we get some signage out there, and I'm thankful that we're finally addressing this.
How quickly will signage be posted? You know how?
I can go back with a magic marker tonight. No, I will get with the, if this ordinance is approved, I will get with the street director tomorrow morning and work on appropriate signage.
Councillor Hannon?
Yeah, I had a couple questions. One, I think you've partially addressed, but I mean, when I heard about this even before being on council, I didn't understand why we couldn't enforce loitering and public nuisance laws as people were skateboarding down there or causing a public nuisance. I guess your answer is by making it crystal clear there, it makes it easier for enforcement and less likely to have a suit brought against us. Is that, I mean, are those the issues, or?
Well, it gives the police department this tool. And also, just historically, in some cities, very broad and vague anti-loitering laws have been used for improper purposes. And so I made sure that when I drafted this, it was very specific, so people who read it know what conduct is illegal and what conduct is allowed.
The second question is, which parking garages this is affect? Because again, I know that there were a couple folks talking about the Veterans Way, but I know the concern are also other garages in Midtown. So specifically, which parking garages does this cover?
As written, it covers all city parking garages, and also gives the option to the owners of private garages. In many cases, we've required, as part of their approval process, to have a public parking section in their private garage, and it allows, through the proper posting by private garage owners, to avoid loitering in the public parking sections of their private garages.
So just because I'm not clear, are all garages in Midtown owned by the city? Is that correct? Maybe Henry knows? Because I just want to make sure we're not having to come back again, that we're getting the right garages under this, so to speak.
I'm going to phone a friend. Henry?
Okay.
Director Mostetsky.
Most of them, there are some varying mechanisms in the way each one of these garages are done. I believe with respect to the two garages in Midtown, Midtown North and South, it's on land owned by the Carmel Redevelopment Authority, which is captured in here. The Veterans Way garage and the Monon and Main garage and the Design Center garage is on land owned by the Carmel Redevelopment Commission, so that would also be captured in here. And then the private garages we would be talking about would be the Proscenium garage, because it's the city's not involved in any way, it's a developer TIF, the forthcoming Lot 1 garage, similarly a developer TIF. And so that provision would cover private garages going forward.
Mr. Haney did sort of jokingly say we'll get signs up quickly. That may be streets department, but clearly we want police to know about this ASAP. I know Chief had to leave, but making sure that the police, if we pass this tonight, are also on board with fairly quick enforcement. Do they need signage to enforce, or do they just need the ordinance, Steve? You know?
Well, this ordinance requires signage.
Okay.
So that it's clear to people. Also, there is a requirement under Indiana law that an ordinance that carries a monetary penalty be published before it can be enforced with the penalty. And so that'll be done immediately also. I want to make two more points, if I could, very briefly. And one is, this ordinance doesn't stop someone from a lot of our amenities downtown are sort of mixed use, and it certainly doesn't prohibit someone from walking directly through a parking lot to get to some other amenity. That is totally permitted. In fact, certainly people that are parking in a lot or a garage, they have children with strollers, they have people who are disabled in wheelchairs, et cetera, et cetera. This allows 15 minutes to do what needs to be done to get ready to leave the garage. So there are sort of some safety valves for short periods of time. Frankly, I've had this question come up numerous times. What if I want to take a picture over the 15 minutes? You know, cameras are pretty quick. If you can take a picture or two, this doesn't stop you from doing that. But it does set a 15-minute limit so that people don't congregate and loiter.
So, Doug, I have to ask. Here's a scenario. I pull into a parking garage. I'm checking my emails before a meeting. Who determines how long I've been there? Is it just somebody who happens to be in the garage and they think I've been there too long, and you go based off of their what they've been witnessing, or how is this?
Well, police have discretion in how they ticket, but and I don't speak for the chief, but my thought would be either a police officer has to see someone there for 15 minutes or someone that's willing to sign an affidavit saying that they've been there. Most commonly, the police officer would be there for 15 minutes.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Madam President.
Councilor Finkham.
If we wanted to include a private garage in this, well, how would we do that? How could we do the language? So proscenium, if we didn't want to chase them all to proscenium.
In the public parking areas of privately owned garages, they simply have to post signs that are identical or in all substantive respects from the signs the city's posting.
And what on the private areas of the private garages if they wanted the police to enforce that?
This ordinance doesn't cover that.
Correct. So how could we make it so it could? How could we give that some flexibility there? Can we amend it briefly to do that?
I would rather we do that on another day. And the reason I say that, Councillor Finkham, is we're a government, so the Constitution applies. And there are just so many nuances when it comes to private property and taking private property rights. So I'm not saying we couldn't, but I would just ask that that be held for another day, and I'd be happy to research it for you and get back to you promptly.
I guess the question I have to get the councilor
microphone.
The question I have to get the Councilor Hannon's comment or that associates with that is, are we better off letting this sit till the next council meeting where you come back with a proposed change, or do we move on this and then introduce a whole other ordinance?
Well, that's up to the council, but my suggestion would be there's no reason not to pass it now and just amend it later as necessary, because it is sort of a independent clause that we could add. I'm really good at adding sub-paragraphs, so I could certainly do that and get it on the next agenda if that's your... I want to research it, to be honest with you, to make sure we're not stepping on the toes of private property owners.
Well, it was to allow them the option if they wanted the police to enforce it, not to force it upon them, right? That was the intent.
Yeah. I'm sorry, let me make sure I got
it. It was to allow them the opportunity if they wanted to put this in their own garage versus forcing that on them that they had to.
Yes, and it's only as written, it's only the public parking portions of it, and in order to have this apply, they have to put up the sign.
Correct.
Well, Councillor Finkham, what I would like to do though is send this to land use, because I feel like we have some outstanding issues. Unless there is some, if time is of the essence, let me know, but if it can wait for a land use meeting, I would like to give it additional time.
I guess the question was, does it need to go to land use, or can we just hold it over? That was what I was asking, if we just hold it over. But if, to your point, if we need to approve it now and then revisit it.
Madam President.
Councilor Ryder.
Two things. One, the public part, or the private part of the garage, they would have signs, private parking for their residents if they live there or whatever. They already have legal authority to remove from that. So that's covered. Would correct. That not be correct?
That's correct.
I mean, they have the ability to enforce the private parking however they want.
Correct.
Okay. So I'm not sure we need to add it, is what I'm saying, to the private portions of private garages, because they already have assigned spaces to their residents, and if you park there, you're going to get towed.
Yeah, or for congregating people, they simply, you trespass them,
right.
And then if they violate it, you ask them to leave, and if they don't, then they're trespassing, and we already have that covered by separate ordinance.
Correct, and I also had a constituent text during this and ask, what about, like, fireworks? People go on top of the garages to watch fireworks.
That wouldn't be permitted for more than 15 minutes, and I tell you, it's a structural issue as much as... that's the question I've gotten, I mean, in reality. And it's cool to be up there because you can see a lot of fireworks. The structure is not made for that. It's not made for, it's made for vehicles. Certainly, I'm not on council, so you could make an exception, but if you make an exception for that, it weakens the argument. Okay.
I wasn't asking to make an exception.
No,
I'm going to say this carefully.
This is very similar
to curfew and a police officer's discretion.
Except that you're right, except that it's limited to certain areas, and it's very unvague as far as very detailed.
I was more
when
discussing the police officer's discretion.
Councillor Austin,
thank you, Madam President. On the fireworks comment, so it sounds like this is up to officer discretion to enforce it. If there was three people up there watching fireworks causing no harm, an officer could use their discretion to say, that's okay. If there were 50 people up there, which becomes a structural issue, the officers could say, hey, this is too much going on. People are tailgating up here. We are going to use our authority to disperse it. So it sounds like Kevin's saying with curfew, an officer doesn't have to enforce the law. If someone is waiting in their car for more than 15 minutes as their child takes a piano lesson somewhere and they don't want to drive back home because they're waiting there for an hour, I'm sure an officer wouldn't fine them for that. So there is officer discretion here.
Well, I'll use this example. If you're asking me a legal question as to whether you can go 56 miles an hour in a 55-mile-an-hour zone, my legal answer is no. If you're going to ask me a business question as to what are your odds of getting pulled over by going 56 and a 55, my answer is it's probably okay. So there is officer discretion. I will also just mention that I did put in a section. If the car is broken down or if it's a dead battery or a flat tire or something like that, and they need emergency assistance, I put in an exception for that. This has been through a few changes, so I better read it. But actually, if that is not in here, it's in a second version, but that would come under officer discretion as well. I mean, no, I cannot conceive of an officer giving a ticket to someone who has a car that won't start because the battery's dead, as long as they're actively seeking emergency, roadside assistance. So, yes, there is always officer discretion.
Okay, Councillor Kimball.
Yes, I just want to give a little history why this came about. Sophia Square, Councillor Worrell has worked tirelessly to get regulation put in there, and I think it's working very effective now. And then we passed an ordinance not too long ago on Allied Garage, and this is like whack-a-mole. As quick as we can create an ordinance, they find another garage. And right now, this has reached a crisis level because of the students have discovered that there is no ordinances that their behavior can be enforced. And they have literally told the police officers that they cannot enforce them, they can't move them. We're at a crisis point where somebody is going to get hurt. I would like to see this passed tonight, then with an amendment if we need to make anything. It's also disturbing the residences. They're not just, we've got car clubs that like to drive through these garages with the loud mufflers. This just has happened. It hasn't been a slow buildup, but the kids have discovered, and it's spread rapidly among them, that this is behavior that we cannot enforce. And so I'd like to see it passed tonight, and then if we have to amend it.
Councilor Royal.
Thank you, Madam President. The situation, so I wanted to just follow up on Councilor Ryder's comments, because the private garages, I think, are going to be a problem. For the example of Sophia doesn't have any markings for residents, but it is a privately owned garage for the residents as well as the users of the restaurants there. It was a challenging issue, and we now will have the same issue at Proscenium, where there will be Tavern on the Green and Wahlburgers, public parking, which I don't know if it will be discriminated as far as you can park here, but you can't park there. I haven't gotten into that kind of detail, but we are going to have to deal with this. I also agree with Councillor Kimball, because I've talked to Jeff D. and some other residents there. We need to take some action tonight. If we have to come back, I had several more questions regarding, you know, the skateboarding ordinance that we already passed and how that wasn't signed properly, and now we've got to go back, and it seems to me this needs to go with it. But I'm okay passing this now in order to give our officers some kind of at least verbal ability to light a fire under some of these situations, and maybe it won't stand up in court. And we did have a ticket of a car abandoned in the garage. We do have an ordinance already in place for that, if the judge will enforce it.
Right, and just maybe anecdotally, but several police officers have told me that the kids that are congregating up there just say, there's no sign, nothing you can do. So this gives the tool to the officers to do something.
Yeah.
Director Mestetsky, were you wanting to speak about this? I saw you kind of nodding your head back there.
Thank you, Madam President. I think Councillor Finkham and Councillor Worrell kind of hit the nail on the head with respect to privately owned garages. The Redevelopment Commission negotiates, in most cases, that 75% of a garage be open to the public. And then the developer can essentially sign as private the rest of the garage. If you're thinking about a situation like the Proscenium, there's a certain disincentive to actually label those signs as specific uses, because then when the, let's say, office employees are gone, no one is using them, and then they're still restricted, for example, in the evenings. And so I would not want a situation where we've all driven through the garage under City Center where there's a fence that separates the private versus the public. But I wouldn't want to create a situation, and I've dealt in my previous life with what private trespass laws are, and they're much tougher to enforce than this kind of sign that you would put up. So I wouldn't want a situation where a developer has this in the public portion of a Proscenium garage. By the way, the garage in the Proscenium, there's no fence. It's just all one space. And the car club just drives over next to all the reserve spaces and says, hey, good luck, police, but we're in the reserve area now, the private area. It seems to me like you would want uniform signage everywhere. But I totally agree that then this section can be added in a later amendment.
Councilor Ryder.
Madam President, without objection, I'd like to suspend the rules and act on this evening with our attorney
doing as Councillor Finkham had asked and research and figure out what to do with the private sections.
Second.
Any discussion? All right, please vote on suspending the rules and voting tonight. All right, it is unanimous.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? Again, please vote. All right, this ordinance has been passed. Item 15, we have no agenda add-on items. Number 16, other business. 16A, the Carmel Cable Telecommunications Commission. Term expires March 31st, 2022. It's a two-year term, one appointment. I did ask the council to submit resumes of people if they wanted to nominate someone. We did receive a resume from Shannon Menar, our current appointee, who would like to be reappointed.
So moved.
Second.
Move we close nominations.
Second.
All right, nominations have been closed. And we are voting to approve Shannon Menar as our appointee. All right, Shannon will continue on the Cable and Telecommunications Commission. 16B, property abatements compliance with statement of benefits. Deadline was June 15th, 2020. As Councillor Finkham, our finance chair, mentioned earlier, that all of these were to have completed a CF1. The council will discuss this in the next finance committee meeting to determine if they are compliant. But I do have to read each of these into the record. Digital Mobile Innovations, Allegiant, Protective Insurance Company, Baldwin & Lyons, Belden Incorporated, Capital Bank & Trust Company, Next Gear Capital Dealer Services Corporation, Meridian Medical Partners, LLC, Mid-Continent Independent System Operator, Incorporated, also known as MISO, the Capital Group Companies, Blue Horseshoe Solutions, Schlage Lock Company, LLC, and Braun Corporation. And again, this will be discussed at the July 8th meeting. We have no other announcements, so pending execution of documents, we can be adjourned.
So moved.
Do I have a second to adjourn? Thank you. We are adjourned.
Of it, the investment in the roads and the infrastructure so that we would support our building. And they were tremendous to work with. They had the right kind of mindset.